And working with dogs with acute colitis, as a clinician, I really need to try and sort out, based on my comprehensive history and my physical exam, how in-depth I need to go with my diagnostic approach. That really has to be focused on figuring out whether I think this is a primary infectious cause or a non-infectious cause. Most owners that bring their dogs to veterinarians for acute colitis are doing so because it's annoying. Nobody wants to clean up diarrhea in their house or have to take their animal out multiple times outside. So in humans, a lot of times that have acute colitis, it can be self-resolving because they don't seek urgent care from their physicians. But in animals, that's a different story. So when I'm presented with dogs that have colitis, I have to figure out how in depth I want to go. If a patient is stable, they have a normal physical exam, they usually greet me at the front of the exam room wagging their tail, those cases are unlikely to really need in-depth diagnostic workup depending on your history. Those are the animals that are gonna benefit most from supportive care. Now, if I walk in the room and a patient's laying there, barely lifts its head to greet me in the room, and on my physical exam, I notice things such as dehydration, tachycardia, I'm gonna change my plan. I need to get more history from the owner to decide how concerned I am about testing for various infectious diseases. Based on the history that you get from the owner will help guide you of what diagnostics you need to do. It wouldn't be uncommon for us to do a fecal flotation to check for the most common intestinal parasites so that we can address those if needed. Many of us learned in vet school that we should also be doing fecal smears and fecal cytology, and in practice I find those rather limiting for knowing how to clinically interpret and to make therapeutic recommendations on. So routinely those are not things that I'm performing. The other diagnostic that some people talk about is doing fecal cultures. And you can imagine that if you're culturing feces that has tons of organisms in it, this can get really challenging for identifying the underlying etiology of that patient's diarrhea. And so really, if I'm concerned about a specific infectious agent, like let's say I'm worried about salmonella because the dog's been eating a raw food diet or has exposure to horses, I may change the plan and specifically do testing for salmonella instead of just doing widespread diagnostics like fecal culture. As far as microbiome testing, this is a really controversial area in veterinary medicine. And the biggest reason for that is that we have to practice diagnostic stewardship. So as more commercial tests become available for microbiome testing, it's my job to look at the limitations of potentially using those diagnostics. And really what we have to remember is any diagnostic that I order for a patient needs to have an impact on their outcome and therapeutic plan. So although testing for changes in the microbiome are cool and interesting, they don't really help me therapeutically based on the evidence that we have currently. And so at this time, I don't recommend microbiome testing in acute colitis. If a patient has multiple episodes of acute colitis over a 6-month period, or actually has clinical signs that have been lasting for over 3 weeks, then I need to start considering obtaining an intestinal biopsy. So in vet school, I was taught to use metronidazole for these cases of acute colitis. It covers a lot of the infectious causes of colitis in dogs, and it also has an anti-inflammatory effect. And although it resolves clinical signs quickly for my patients, we are now finding that it has lasting impacts on the gut microbiome for my patients. And although overtly, I may not be able to tell that there's an underlying problem, this could have lasting impacts for the overall health of my patients. Finding that lingering dysbiosis could impact not just health within the GI tract long term, but other organ systems as well, since microbiome health is important for things like the heart and the kidneys and the lungs and the brain. And so because of the impacts that the gut microbiome may have on the overall health of my patients, I have to be very judicious in the way that I consider prescribing antimicrobials. as a clinician, if I'm not reaching for metronidazole, what do I do? Because my clients are expecting me to provide some sort of relief for their patient. And in these cases of acute colitis, my first line therapy is gonna be fiber supplementation. So things like psyllium that are unflavored can be prescribed. And actually, clinical trials here out of the Ohio State have shown that they are comparable to giving metronidazole, and they don't have the lingering impacts on the microbiome because psyllium is actually considered to be a prebiotic and provides good nutrient source for the overall health of the microbiome. Another emerging treatment that I reach for in acute colitis cases is fecal transplant. This is where we take feces from a healthy recipient and we put them into patients via rectal enema in those that have colitis. There have been multiple studies that have showed a clinical benefit when used in the acute period, and it's comparable to the impacts of metronidazole, but again, don't have the lasting impacts. Fecal transplant restores the microbiome sooner in patients that have underlying dysbiosis. Since the majority of these cases aren't infectious in nature, prescribing metronidazole really doesn't fall within the guidelines of antimicrobial stewardship. And so unless I have a targeted infectious disease that I need to prescribe metronidazole for a patient, I really should think twice about doing it. Help keep antibiotics useful in both animals and humans.